We're here with criminal defense attorney Lawrence Gund, and we're going to talk about restraining orders. So Larry, what is a restraining order?
A restraining order is what's often called also a protective order. And what that does is it's a court order that prevents a person from harassing, assaulting, threatening, battering, stalking, or abusing another person. The person who's getting the restraining order is referred to as the protected party, and the person who's the restraining order would be against is called the restrained person. It can also include other protected people, maybe other people that live in the house with the protected person, as well as actually including pets. Family pets can be included in a restraining order as well.
All right. Are there different types of restraining orders?
There are four types of restraining orders. There's a domestic violence restraining order, a civil harassment restraining order, a elder abuse or dependent adult restraining order, and also a workplace violence restraining order.
So what exactly does a restraining order do?
Okay. Well, a restraining order can include several things. It includes personal conduct orders, stay away orders, and can also include move out orders for a person. A personal conduct orders will usually encompass things like not attacking, striking, harassing the other person, not stalking them, not communicating with them, be it via telephone, via text message, email, posting on their Facebook wall, Snapchat, Instagram, all those sorts of things. It will be an order from the court that the restrained party is not to do any of those things to the protected party. Well, what a restraining order essentially does is give the protected party a cause to call the police if that restraining order is violated without having to really prove any particular crime beyond the violation of that order. Say if the person has come, it is sitting on your front porch, okay? Now that in and of itself isn't really a crime to sit on someone's front porch. But if you have a restraining order saying they're not allowed to come to your house and they have to stay 100 yards away from you, well then as a violation of the restraining order, then the police would be obligated to show up and certainly could arrest that person for the violation.
Are there things that a restraining order can do other than keep someone from physically assaulting somebody else?
Other than those personal conduct orders, as I mentioned, usually includes stay away orders as well. And these are orders requiring the restrained party to stay a certain distance away from the protected party. A pretty common distance is 100 yards in that situation from what I've seen in the cases that I've handled. Although a judge can make exceptions to that, sometimes say if the people are neighbors and their walls are right against each other, it might not be possible for the people to stay 100 yards away from each other, and a judge will often make some sort of modification of that or say it's an ex-husband and wife, and they're both allowed to go to their high schoolers' basketball games or school plays, things like that. Maybe the auditorium itself isn't 100 yards across. In those sort of situations, a judge can make an exception to that distance requirement. Other specific things that a stay-away order can encompass would be staying away from the person's home, staying away from a place of employment, from their vehicle, and any other important places that the protected party may have to go to. It can, in some situations, it might keep the restrained party from maybe going to their favorite restaurant or maybe to a store that they like to frequent. If the protected party works at that place, they might not be able to go to that restaurant again or that store that they like to go to.
Okay, and I understand that there are domestic violence restraining orders and then there are civil restraining orders. What's the difference between the two?
Those are the two most common types of restraining orders would be the domestic violence and civil harassment. Now, the difference is that domestic violence restraining order is appropriate when the parties have either have had an intimate relationship, be it husband and wife, ex-spouses, boyfriend, girlfriend, or any two people who have lived together in an intimate relationship. It can also include blood relatives, such as brother and sister, parents and children, all the way out to grandparents, can be included in a domestic violence restraining order. A civil harassment restraining order would apply in most other cases where people do not have that intimate relationship. Maybe they are just roommates, okay? In that kind of situation, even though we're living together, but they're just roommates, they don't have an intimate relationship. In that situation, you would want a civil harassment restraining order. Or maybe it's, I've seen it where it's coworkers. A coworker feel they're being harassed, and they want a civil harassment restraining order, which obviously creates some difficulties because they're working in the same place. But I've actually seen employers figure out a way to accommodate that in that sort of situation. It would also be appropriate. Occasionally, you have a stranger who is fixated on you for some reason. And that, again, would be a situation for a civil harassment restraining order.
Okay, so is it the case then that for a restraining order to be granted, there doesn't have to be physical abuse?
Well, say for a civil harassment restraining order, there doesn't necessarily have to be physical abuse, but there would have to be some showing of at least stalking or threatening behavior that either has affected you or there's reasonable cause that you may be abused from it. In the case of a domestic violence restraining order, in addition to those things, it can also include emotional abuse, psychological abuse can be part of it. So the gamut is a little bit wider. I should say the net is a little bit wider in a domestic violence restraining order in terms of those sorts of activities that might warrant the granting of that order.
Okay, and if someone owns firearms and they have a restraining order placed against them, would they have to get rid of those firearms?
In most all cases, they would. They may have to sell them. They can't actually store them with the police or the sheriff's department. They could give them to another party. In most cases, they will have to, if they have them, get rid of them or will be prevented from obtaining them for the duration of that restraining order.
Okay, and could a restraining order require someone to move out of their own home?
In terms of a domestic violence restraining order, it could. In situations, again, where people are living together in an intimate relationship, the restrained party could be ordered to move out, and in many cases does have to do that. That obviously can create a financial strain on the couple or the family. The other person has to go get an apartment or stay with a friend or do something like that. So the consequences can be significant.
Now, pursuant to a restraining order, can a judge order someone to take classes or attend some kind of treatment?
A judge can. Do that. The range could be anywhere from a 52-week batterer intervention course to a handful of weeks of maybe anger management classes, or if there are children involved in the restraining order matter, possibly parenting classes. For whatever length of time the judge thinks is appropriate, depending on the circumstances of the case.
Okay, and how long would a restraining order typically last?
Well, a restraining order can last up to a maximum of 5 years. Typically, what I've seen is 3 years is not an uncommon length of time. I've seen 1 year. I've actually seen them issued for as little as 3 months, depending on the situation. If the judge thinks that maybe say the incident just arose out of some unusual set of circumstances. He might give a fairly short time, maybe with some anger management classes or parenting classes, something like that, and essentially give the person a chance to redeem themselves, if you will. Now, with that being said, if the protected party, that time passes or is almost ready to pass and the person feels like they are still in danger, they can go in and ask for an extension of that restraining order based on whatever facts they might have, including even if it's the maximum 5-year length of time, a person can go in short of that 5-year mark and ask the restraining order be continued if they have some grounds to believe they're still in danger.
Right. And what happens if someone violates a restraining order that they have against them?
They could be arrested. They can be arrested. They can do some jail time for a violation of a restraining order.
So what would I do if I needed to obtain a restraining order?
You could go to court. There's paperwork to fill out. It's something you can do yourself, or you can get the assistance of an attorney to help you do that. Because the process is, initially you'll fill out paperwork basically stating why you are in fear, what has happened to you or what you anticipate will happen to you, maybe based on threats that have been made towards you. And that paperwork will go to the judge. He will read the paperwork, he or she will read the paperwork, and based on that alone, they will decide whether a temporary restraining order should be issued. The respondent does not have to be present at that hearing. In fact, there really isn't a hearing. The judge just looks at the paperwork, decides if what is written on that paper warrants grounds for the restraining order to be granted. If he does, like I said, then a temporary restraining order will be put in place, and that usually lasts about a few weeks until you can have a hearing for what they call the permanent restraining order. And that is also true even if the temporary is not granted. There will still be a date set for the hearing, again, for what they call the permanent restraining order, although that's a bit of a misnomer because really the maximum is 5 years. And on that date, there will be essentially like a bench trial. Okay, which means there is no jury, but the evidence will be presented in front of a judge by the person requesting the restraining order, okay, presenting their evidence why they think it should be granted, and the person who it's against presenting evidence as to why it shouldn't be granted, why maybe they didn't do the things that they're accused of, and I've seen that happen frequently. People have different motivations for requesting restraining orders.
Now, what do I do if someone's trying to get a restraining order granted against me?
Assuming that TRO is granted, you will then be notified of the orders in that temporary restraining order, which probably will involve not contacting the person, not striking them or hitting them, of course, probably staying some certain distance away from them. And you'll get a court date for when the restraining order, the hearing for the permanent restraining order is going to be. Now you can respond in writing to that as to why you disagree with whatever has been requested in that restraining order, which I'd say is recommended so that the judge has advance notice of what your contentions are with the situation, and then you will show up in court and again have to present evidence as to maybe why you didn't do what you're being accused of, or why it doesn't rise to the significance of needing a restraining order against you.
Okay, and if a restraining order is granted against me, what kind of implications can that have in my life?
Well, it can keep you from going to certain places that you may want to go to. Of course, it will keep you from away from that person who's requested the restraining order. In the case of a domestic violence restraining order, say if there are custody issues, it could keep you from seeing your kids as well. Or it may require supervised visitation with your kids, which can be expensive because you will have to hire a person to supervise those visitations with your children, and that sometimes, as a practical matter, ends up in a person not being able to see their kids.
So Larry, it sounds like courtroom procedure in matters involving restraining orders can get pretty complicated, and it's a good idea to have an attorney on your side regardless of whether you're the petitioner or the respondent.
Yeah, I think that it is. On that note, I think it's important to know that there are different levels of proof required in a restraining order matter than in a criminal matter. For example, in a criminal matter, as a lot of people know from watching TV, it's proof beyond a reasonable doubt, which is a very high level of proof that's required to prove a criminal case. In a restraining order matter, the level is significantly lower. In a domestic violence restraining order matter, it's just a preponderance of the evidence, which really just means just more than 50% required in order to grant that restraining order. In a civil harassment restraining order, it's actually called clear and convincing evidence. And it's difficult to put an exact percentage on it, but it's basically the middle ground between 50% and proof beyond a reasonable doubt. I think the thinking there is in, of course, because these cases are often a matter of he said, she said, especially in domestic violence restraining matters, they do kind of tip the scales towards the safety of the person in case they maybe don't have really as much proof as a person may have, again, in a criminal type of matter.
Okay, well, thank you very much. If you or anyone you know has a restraining order matter, please feel free to give us a call at the Kann California Defense Group, and we'd be happy to discuss it with you.